The growing number of black homeowners fueled speculation that West Indians were raising the money for houses from prostitution and racketeering. In fact, they had brought a far less exotic method with them from the Caribbean.
People from the Caribbean were bringing with them certain things. The first thing that I'm conscious of is the system that people call susu, partner, or box, which means that you get a circle of friends and they all put a certain amount of money in every week, and every week somebody gets a lump sum that's made up of all the money that each one puts in. And that enabled people to buy houses and give them the deposit for houses.
They accumulated sums of money and they bought property. And that caused an impasse, that caused a problem, because people were wondering how they were getting this money to buy these property. And so the label of running prostitutes on the streets, selling dope and all of that sort of thing arose.
Resentment against West Indians was now reaching its boiling point. Racial hostility was increasingly accompanied by violence.
I used to carry a piece of steel bar, you know, in my sleeve, because you never know. I mean, you know, I mean, if you saw three or four white guys moving towards you, man, I mean, you had to be sharp, because you never know what they're gonna do.
Tell the boys, whenever time they see a black person in the street, they'd fight. It is a fight. And if they happens to know a white woman is going with a black man, she were taunted, nigger lover, and also beaten up.
By the late 1950s, the rich promise of the mother country was turning sour. The immigrants' disillusionment was complete.
It was an age of tremendous cruelty to black people. You know, tremendous cruelty. You know, it's now in reflection, 30 years later, you're looking at it and saying, my God, how did we survive? How did we survive all of these things? You know, the racism, the pressure, you know, the odd hours. I mean, so I used to go on the tube in the morning, and all you saw were rows of elderly black women going to work in the hospitals, going to clean, going to do the dirty jobs, you know, and nobody wanted. And after they'd gone, then half an hour later, you see the men going out to work on the building sites, to go and do, you know, this place, bomb sites, right, to go and rebuild it. The second industrial revolution in England was mainly worked out by the blacks and the Irish. We took these bomb sites in the cities and put these big, bloody buildings, which they've got there right now. And what did we get? Probably get a kick up the ass when you got back home because somebody was throwing you out of your home. Yeah. I don't know. So, it was an unforgiving time.
The ugly cocktail of bigotry, envy, and sexual jealousy was bound to find a focus. It came in the streets of Nottingham in the summer of 1958.
There was the term known by the Teddy Boy circle when they're going out to attack black. They call it black burying. And so that sort of problem was there. And people just feel enough is enough.
West Indians in Nottingham reacted to the increasing violence against them by fighting back. In one notorious incident, a West Indian known as Roy led an impulsive act of defiance.
Well, what happened? He was at a party, and as soon as they heard that there was this disturbances at a pub nearby the Robin Hood Chase, they all decided, well, we must get there. And he got in his car with a few others and went there, and there was this milling crowd, and he felt the best way, well, I better drive through this. And he went through it at full tilt as quickly as he could. I think a policeman must get bounced on the backside or something like that. I remember when Roy was telling me, I said, but look, man, that was dangerous. He said, Eric, you're too damn nice a chap, man. It gives me satisfaction. At least we can fight back. You know, at least we can fight back, and people will realize we're not prepared to sit and take this sort of thing anymore.
After 2 weeks of running battles, the disturbances in Nottingham subsided. But just days later, trouble broke out on the streets of London's Notting Hill. The riot that erupted shocked the nation. It was a white riot, one which would shatter relations between black and white for a generation. A decade after the Empire Windrush had brought 500 West Indians to Britain, tens of thousands followed. They expected a warm embrace from the mother country. Instead, they found a cold shoulder. Those who had fought beside them in the war now treated them like foreigners who threatened their jobs and their homes. The Notting Hill riots shook Britain, and they would open a new era of intolerance. This is the story of the journey from the streets of Notting Hill to the rivers of blood.
In 15 or 20 years' time, the black man will have the whip hand over the white man.
And it is also the story of change, from post-war austerity to the birth of a new vibrant edge to British culture.
When we come over here, we brought music, we brought color, we brought dope, you know, we brought life to this goddamn country.
Summer 1958, Notting Hill. This run-down district of London, where many West Indians had settled, would become a byword for white hostility towards black immigrants. But the spark that ignited 6 weeks of violence was a seemingly mundane domestic quarrel on a hot July evening.
The day before the riot started, you got a bloke named Ramon and his wife, we know her as Tanya. They had a fight, and the white people didn't like it, so they went to help her out. Eventually, she turned on them and started to fight them. So they said, we turn them their own people against them.
This single incident was the set of an explosion of white anger the following night.
Saturday night, and I was having this dance, and we heard like a swarm of bees coming. Although the music were playing loud, we could hear the noise from outside. So I went to the top door and look out, and I saw some mass people, a lot of people coming, with a police van in front, a dog angler in front of the van. And when they reached where the music were playing, they just stopped. And with so much people, they couldn't control them. They started throwing bricks and anything like that in the building.
I looked through the fifth floor window where I was, and there was a battle between black men, policemen, white yabos and teddy boys. I mean, the street wasn't lighted except for fires and that, Molotov cocktails and so on. Blood was everywhere, and it was awful.
That night's riot would be just the opening salvo.